We are in session 10 today. We will be looking into a lot of access modifiers, what we have in .NET language, especially with C# and VB.NET. And we'll see the list of access modifiers, what is a friend assembly, and we'll see a unit test creation in VS 2010. How can we create and how can we run the tests inside a Visual Studio? And the default access modifiers, if you don't specify any access modifiers explicitly, what will be taken implicitly by the language compiler. Okay, so saying that, let's kick off with the access modifiers today. Okay, so the access modifiers, what are they? When you design and program, you want to have a set of classification within your classes. Since if you remember, object-oriented programming is all about the real-time objects representation, and when you talk about the real-time object representation, they do have some kind of a control, like who can access what, who can do what, and so on. Just a typical example if I give you. Since we already talked about the automobile class and we have cars, trucks, and so on, and in my domain object model, I have someone called a driver. A driver is again a general. If you take it to take a driver as a general abstract concept, so a driver is nothing but a human being, right? So if you take it a little higher, then again this animal classification comes into play, wherein within that you have a mammals, and within mammals and also we don't want to go there. But within the business context, you will have a different set of objects evolved. Or like in this case, you have a car and a driver. So the driver is a class and the car is a class, and definitely you don't want to inherit driver with car, because they don't fall into the inheritance hierarchy. If you match that, what kind of qualities that you want to inherit from car doesn't make sense, right? So car is a separate entity in its own space, whereas a driver is a separate entity. So the relationship between the both the objects is driver drives car. So that's the relationship. So we see these kind of restrictions applied, right? You want to restrict who can access what and who can do what on your real-time objects. So the access modifiers will give you that to implement. So it's pretty simple. We have it's all about controlling the access in a single line. If you say it's a access modifiers is all about controlling the access of the class members. The class members, if you say, we have seen a state and behavior as a two core categories or two core classification what a class can contain. So the class can contain a state and behavior, and the state is nothing but the properties and the behavior is methods or functions or anything. So we control the access on these properties and methods so that when I define something, so I restrict who can access them, who can override them, who can make use of them, and so on. So there's wide variety of restrictions you can apply. So this is a time I would like to take you back to our earlier sessions wherein we were talking about the assemblies. Okay, so assemblies again play a very important role when we talk about the access modifiers. So if you quickly ask what is an assembly, so assembly contains MSIL and manifest, which is a metadata. An assembly is a single unit of deployment, which is pretty much refers to a DLL or an EXE that you get once you compile a project. Okay, so within an assembly in general we'll have n number of classes, right? So n number of classes, it's again needless to refer. I just opened this sample code. So assembly A is one of the project which is having n number of other classes within it. Okay, so this becomes an assembly. So you can specify the access modifiers at various levels. At class level you can specify, at method level or member level you can specify. So we will limit our session to the member level access modifiers, and we'll see each of the access modifiers what they restrict to. Okay, so there are literally five types of access modifiers in .NET. The first one is the private, which we have already seen. Private members, we create a private member and expose that using a public property. So private members we have already seen. Public members also we have seen as a properties having a public access modifier. So public members have no restrictions. So once you declare a field or a property or a method public, they are accessible anywhere in your program or even outside the program. So they can be accessed. So the protected is a special class, internal is again special class, and protected internal. So I will give you a very easy tip to remember what is what. Okay, so otherwise without a tip it's going to be like a very messy, so every time you get confused with the cross keywords. Okay, so private, we are clear, right? Private means it's my private. If I have it, then only I can access it in general. So that means if you have any, if you declare any private members in a class, only they are accessible only from within the class, not anywhere. Okay, so that means it's private. What is a public? As we said, no restrictions, it's wide open, so anyone can access it and anyone can use it. They are pretty much clear. So when you come to protected, so protected are the ones which can be accessed within the inheritance hierarchy. If you remember, we did the inheritance, we have a base class, we have derived class, so on. So members that are protected can be accessed only in the inheritance hierarchy. That means in our earlier example, we have automobile, car and flying car, so on. So if you have anything protected in automobile, so flying car can access it because it falls under the inheritance hierarchy. Okay, so keep it related to the inheritance only. And when it comes to internal, internals are accessible throughout the assembly. So if you have assembly A and assembly B, so if you declare anything called internal, then that means internal to the assembly. Okay, and the equivalent keyword in vb.end is friend. So when I declare any field or property or method as a friend, so the friend is ever accessible throughout the assembly. If you remember, assembly can have any number of classes. Okay, and protected internal is a combination of both, which is a internal, that means it can be accessed throughout your assembly where it is declared, and also in the classes across assemblies whichever inherited. So when you say inheritance hierarchy can span across assemblies. Okay, if assembly A, assembly B, so B can inherit classes within assembly A, so it can go out of the assembly scope. So that means protected members are accessible in the inheritance hierarchy. That means inheritance hierarchy can span across assemblies. Okay, we'll see one by one. So this diagram took a long time to just wanted to try to demonstrate this in an easy way. So finally, this is the best way I thought I could put it to you. If you see, this is a private member. Unfortunately, for access modifiers, there's nothing like I can run the code and show you. I will definitely show you the code, but at the compiler time itself, it's going to give you the error if something got not accessible. Okay, to keep it simple, here I have two assemblies, assembly A and assembly B, and I have one public class here, which has a private property and a private method. Okay, I'm trying to access these from another class which is a derived public class within the same assembly, which is an assembly A. So this derived public class is inheriting the public class. Okay, so I kept the names of the each and everything to be mapped directly to the access modifiers. Okay, so to keep our understanding simple. So this is a class, I just made it as a public class. Okay, and this is a derived class, derived from public class, which is inherited from public class. Okay, and this has a main method, say it's a behavior, we have some method or some function. So in since we are doing only the console applications, main is our main method. Okay, and within that I have a property, and this property is a private. Okay, private property. If you see the class diagram icon itself is self-explanatory, so the lock symbol itself says that it is private. Okay, and also I have a private method. So all the slides what I'm going to show going forward will follow the same pattern. So only thing will be different is will be within the public class. So I will show the respective access modifier within the public class, and the rest all others will be same, and we'll see these arrows. The color of the arrow will be important. In this case, when it is blue, that means it is good to go, that means it can access it. When it is red in color, it means it cannot access it. Okay, so that's the indication of the diagrams that you're going to see from now on. So in this case, I have a private property within the assembly A, class public class, and if you see, there's only one blue line. That means it can be accessed only from within the class. Okay, either using a property or a method or anything else, but only within the class. So there is another class within the same assembly, which is assembly A, has a derived public class, and it is inheriting from this class. Although it is inheriting, it cannot access the private members. So that's why if you see, it's the red in color. Okay, and the next step will be the assembly B. So there's another assembly B. Here we have another derived public class, which is actually deriving from public class. So if you see the difference between this derived public class and this derived public class is that this derived public class is within this assembly, the other one is in a separate assembly. Okay, and I have another class which is a public class, which is actually not having any inheritance hierarchy. It's not inheriting to any other. It's just a class of its own. So it's a public class here. So this public class in assembly A is different from public class in assembly B. So the private members, if you see, all are in red. So they can be accessed only from within the class. Okay, so we will, how are we going to declare? You can declare it using a private. We have already seen this. We'll just quickly go back to the code and demo that. Okay, so we are in assembly A. We don't want to go to assembly B right now. Assembly A, I have a public class within which I have, we have seen, we have one private property, and I'm creating an instance of my public class here, which is obj public class, and I'm trying to access obj public class dot property, private property. Okay, and also I'm accessing private property here, and I don't have any issues. So because this private property is declared within the same public class. Okay, now I will try to access this from a different class, which is in this case I'll go to the derived class. So this derived public class is actually inheriting the public class. Okay, so in general, if there is another class which is not referring to this in any way, then there is no question that you can access a private member. So in this case, we're just going to one step down wherein we're trying to derive it from public class and see if that is accessible. And yep, this I'm going to take care. Okay, so this is a private property, Okay, so this is another private property. So am I able to access this? What is the error? And now, yeah, there we go. So we see the error saying private method is not accessible, is inaccessible due to its protection level. So what it means is I am not able to access the public class private members from a derived class. Okay, so both the instances, it's throwing up an error, so it cannot be accessed. So that's what it means, what we are trying to show here. So assembly A has a private member and that can be accessed only from within the class, and it cannot be accessed anywhere outside that class. It can be in another class within the same assembly or in any other classes outside the assembly. Okay, hope that's clear. The next one is a public. So if you see, all are blue. So that means it can be accessed from anywhere. It doesn't matter you are within the same class or outside the class within the same assembly or another assembly and other classes, either it is inheriting or not inheriting, doesn't matter. Okay, so everything is accessible and we'll do that a quick demo. So we are also here. So in this case, I'll straight away jump to this. So private is cribbing, but public it should not crib. Okay, derived class and accessing the public member of the other one, and that is within the same assembly. Okay, we will try to run this code and see what's the output we get, and we are good. Public property and public method, we are inside the derived public class and we are accessing the assembly A dot derived public class, assembly A dot derived public class, a public property which is accessible. So within the assembly we are good. So we will see outside the assembly. Okay, so to make our outside the assembly, we have to comment the main, we have to keep this main and go to public here, and here I'm okay to give a recap. So this is an assembly A that is referred in assembly B. So how did I do that? By simply going, adding a reference here. So we did discuss about the various tabs here available in our Visual Studio sessions, and under the projects tab, I have the assembly A that I can add a reference to my project. And this is a project reference. So once I add the assembly A reference here, I can able to access the class inside them. Assembly A. So I am in the assembly B here. So I'm actually accessing the assembly A from here. Let me expand this. So everything got commented out. So I'm going to uncomment. Okay, so this private cannot be accessed, and public similarly, this private cannot be accessed from outside, so public can be accessed, if you see. Okay, so I am actually creating an instance of an assembly A public class here. We are within the assembly B. This is an assembly B namespace and we are in the assembly B. And in the main method, I'm trying to create an assembly A instance and then accessing its members. So I'm able to access the public one, private I couldn't access it, and similarly public method I'm able to access it. So in order to run the assembly B, I'm going to make it as a current project and then I'm going to run. So it ran successfully. It says assembly B, we are in assembly B and we are trying to access the public property of assembly A. So across assembly also it is good. Okay, so we are good with the public, no issues. So if you see the red and blue, so the wired gap, you see the private members can access only the local ones, which is only one blue, and public members everything is blue, so no restrictions anywhere of any kind. And now comes the internal or the friend. If you carefully see the blue and reds, everything within the assembly is blue, and whichever is coming from the other assembly is red. So as we discussed, internal members are accessible from within the assembly, irrespective of any class within the assembly. So in public class, which is a base class, we have an internal property, and it is accessible through the derived classes. And also another class, we have a private class, which is not in the inheritance hierarchy. So that means it is not inheriting any of these two, but still it can access the internal members, assembly A. Within the assembly A, everything is blue. So whatever is coming from outside the assembly, they cannot access it. So if you take the general definition of internal, they are accessible throughout the assembly. Okay, we'll see that. Okay, I'm trying to access it from outside the assembly. Okay, we can keep this, not a problem. And internal, I'm trying to access it, and it says no, could not be found. It just simply says this could not be found. So internals are completely accessible or from within the assembly. So from assembly B, I cannot able to access the internal property or internal method, which is clear. So I'm going to comment it out again. Okay, and I will go back to the assembly A. I'll make this as a startup project, and I will try to access. Oh, I'm sorry, I think I have to uncomment this. We'll do it again. So I did not uncomment this. Okay, so I just uncomment the internal method and also internal property. Okay, we'll try to access this from the other one. So okay, and I'll build this, and there you go. So it says it's not able to access that. It's trying to say, did you forget to add a reference to that assembly and all, but because it's simply not accessible, so it's not visible to the compiler or anyone. So it says you're missing something, you're trying to use it without adding a reference to it, so on. So because it's simply not available at all, so its internal property is not available in the assembly B. So as per definition, it should be available from within the assembly A. So we have it in the public class. Okay, so we'll keep this. Okay, we don't want to do this, and we'll straight away go to the public class. Okay, so here we were actually trying to access the public, which is accessible, and okay, not protected. We want to do internal. Internal, it should be accessible, and also public we have crossed, and internal we, okay. So we're trying to access this internal member from within the same class. So the compiler did not crib anything, so it's good. So internal members can be accessed from within their local. So that is proven. So within the same class, that means it's pretty much equal to a private member, right? Within the same class, I'm able to access an internal member. At this stage, it doesn't make any difference between a private and internal. So what makes a difference? When I try to access this from outside this class. Okay, so we are inside the another class. Oh, I will again take this internal code out, private code out, okay, public. So let me see if I can access internal here and also internal here. compile this, and Bill got succeeded. That means I can access the internal members from within the any classes within the inheritance within the assembly. Sorry. So assembly A, any classes inside assembly A can access an internal member. Okay, that's clear. So whenever you say internal, then just refer to the internal as an assembly. So it can be accessed from within the assembly. So if you, all the blues, if you see, irrespective of the classes, whether they are in inheritance hierarchy or not, they all can access an internal member of another class. Clear? An internal keyword is the one that is used to create or declare the access modifier in C#. And the equivalent keyword in VB.NET is friend. Okay, among all the keywords, only internal is different in VB.NET, which is termed as friend. Otherwise, rest all are same. Okay, that's the key thing to remember. The next thing is protected members. Okay, so if you see this, this is a little mix. Okay, but if you carefully see, as I said, protected members are accessible throughout the inheritance hierarchy. Okay, so if you see, you have a derived public class in assembly B, which has a blue line. That means it can access the protected member. And also, I have another derived public class, which is derived from this public class, and it also can able to access the protected member. So that means the only commonality here is the derived members can access the protected members. So if you see the private class here, which is another class within the same assembly, but this is an isolated one. This is not having any inheritance relationship with these, any of these two classes. So that means this cannot access a protected member within another class. And similarly with another class which is outside this assembly, but this doesn't have any inheritance relationship, so it cannot again access it. So protected members can be accessed within the inheritance hierarchy. That's a clear shot. It can be within the assembly or outside the assembly. Okay, so we'll see that also. Hope you guys are getting it pretty easily. So it's a very straightforward, I'm trying to put it. Okay, so protected member, it can't able to access it because I have to uncomment the code here. So I have my protected property here. I'm going to uncomment this out. Internal and protected. And then behavior-wise, you can actually download this code and try yourself or start writing your own code and see these properties, access modifiers. Okay, so within the assembly, the derived class can able to access the protected member. Okay. And we have seen this, so we'll also check if this is accessible. From within the public class, so obviously it should be. Okay, so within the, so we are with the public class here, and I'm going to uncomment this one, and also this one. So it should be accessible without any doubt, because this is a local anyway. So if I run, I can able to see the protected member, internal member, which is from within the same class. So now the last step will be to access this from the assembly B. So within the assembly B, I have a public class here, and this class is actually a standalone one. It's not in deriving from the public class in assembly A. So we will try to see if I can access the protected member. Okay, so it's cribbing, it's not going to allow. The protected members are not accessible because this class is not inherited from that class. So that's why you cannot access it. So we have another class which is inheriting. So we'll see if we can access it from there. Okay, so this is a derived member. So to make this work, I have to comment the main method here. So I just have this region, I can take this whole thing, comment out, and come to derived member and uncomment this. Okay, so within this derived member, what are we have? I can have this internal I don't want, private I don't have, I have public members I have. So here I don't want this. What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to access the protected member, which I am able to. Okay, so I think we didn't check this one. So if this is a derived member, and this is trying to, if you try to access the internal member, what will happen? Can I access it? Because it's outside the assembly. This is in the assembly B. So that's an assembly A member. Let me compare. So it cannot. So internal members are accessible only from within the respective assembly. So I'm in assembly B, I'm trying to access the internal member of assembly A, which is not allowed. Okay, as simple as internals are available only from within the assembly. Okay, so I can able to access the protected members, but because this class is inheriting from public class. Okay, so that's the key difference. So whichever inherit from the class can again access to the protected members. Okay, it's pretty straightforward. And the last one is the protected friend. It is nothing but the combination of protected and friend. So friend are available throughout the assembly. If you see from within the assembly, everything is blue. And also, since it is protected, it can also be accessed from the inheritance hierarchy. That means it can span across the next assembly also. Whichever is inheriting, they can access it. But whichever is not inheriting cannot access the protected friend members. Okay, so that's the only difference here. So we'll see the protected friend also. So the only difference is that it should not be accessible from public class, which is not inheriting, and it's outside the assembly. So from within the derived inheritance hierarchy, I should able to access this one. Okay, it's still cribbing. We'll see why. Can you tell me why? It's cribbing because the code in the public class is commented. So I just have to uncomment this one. So this is the protected internal member. I did not uncomment one of the other piece. Okay, it is done. So the both the items, the behavior is done, and the protected internal state is done. And okay, so where am I? So I'm inside the derived class in assembly B. There you go. That's only the compiler thing. The background compiler is not that good in C sharp. I just have to compile this explicitly. Okay, so it's able to access from within the inheritance hierarchy. So the public class is the base one in assembly A, and this derived public class in assembly B. So across assemblies, I can able to access the protected internal member. Okay, and here it's also. So the internal and protected internals can be accessed. So I'm able to access from outside the assembly, and I'll try to access it from outside the assembly within the public class. For this, I should comment this out. One step higher, commented this level. It's going to be pretty neat, otherwise it's going to be very messy. Okay, see, the regions are really so helpful. So that I have a ton of code written, but I don't want to use the whole code just to make it simple. Okay, and here I'm trying to access the protected internal member. So can I access it? I shouldn't be, right? Yep, I shouldn't be, because this class is an isolated one which is not inheriting from the assembly A public class or any other classes. So this is an assembly B, so it cannot access a protected internal, because protected internals are available only from the within the assembly where they got declared, and also any other classes or any other assemblies which are in the inheritance hierarchy. So in this case, I cannot access this one. Okay, so that's all about it, protected members. So if you see, only there is only one red left out, that means the class which is not in inheritance hierarchy and also not within the same assembly, so it cannot access it. So that's about the protected internal members. So this is one of the diagram or the union diagram that I saw online, which could make some sense to you if at all, because since we had some overview. So if you see the public scope, it's completely wide open. It's oval. Outside the assemblies, other assemblies, and this assembly that inherits, and also the assembly in the base, so it's completely open. And if you see the protected internals, or the next one, which can be accessed from within the assembly, as also the other outside the assembly, which participate in the inheritance hierarchy. Okay, if you see, these arrows are pointing to the inheritance hierarchy. And the next one is a protected, which is again accessible from within the inheritance hierarchy, which is out again span across the assemblies, and internal is again internal to the whole assembly, so its scope is accessible within the assembly. And private, it's only accessible within the class. So it's a pretty neat diagram and well done. Only thing is, once you have some overview, it will really make sense. Otherwise, this is going to be very hazy or confusing diagram. I hope it is clear to you, and probably if I ask a question on the access modifiers, you can definitely answer, which I will in the next session. Keep it in mind, and also refer to any of the articles online if at all you think you need to know more. But be careful. Material outside on the internet will be very, very confusing if at all you're completely new to that, because no one will tell you straightforward the way I just described, as specific to inheritance hierarchy or specific to assembly and so on. So they will give you a lengthy of text, a paragraph of text that might be more difficult to understand. So if you just have a fair idea right now, then probably this is the right time to jump into the text and read more and know where you can use, how you can use, and all that stuff. I can give you some of the examples also. When can you use each of these? So this slide, it talks about a special kind of an assembly, which is a friend assembly. A friend assembly is, again, this is specific to the .NET again, both the languages included, C# and VB.NET, wherein if you declare any, if you declare any member as a friend, that can be accessed only within the assembly, not outside the assembly, okay? So you can actually access the friend members of another assembly into another assembly if you make the assembly itself is as a friend. Okay, so friend assemblies can access the friend members of the other classes. So in this case, there is a special attribute called assembly colon internals visible to. So this makes the assembly expose all the internal members to the assembly. So you're actually also specifying that this is visible to only this assembly B. So if you're in assembly A and you want to expose all of its internal members to a specific assembly, then you can do that with an assembly attributes. So remember, if you see with the square brackets, and ending with the square brackets in C#, that are decorated decorators at the class level. These are class level decorators. These are called attributes. So in other words, these are the class level attributes that you can add to specify to expose the internal members visible to a given assembly. And the same, similarly, the only the syntax is different here. So using this, you can actually expose all your friend members. In this case, we have a friend class. And yeah, in this case, you have friend method. So there are two classes. We can have the access modifier specified to the class and also access modifier specified to a method. Similarly, a property also. So you can do both. And in this case, all these friend members are available in the assembly B also. So when will this be useful? This is useful for automated testing. This is a pretty much new feature that is added up along with the unit test edition that is added up to the Visual Studio, where you can create test cases in the Visual Studio itself to unit test your code. So it's pretty easy. In fact, in Visual Studio, if you want to really create any test cases, let me try that here. It's as simple as going to the respective method. So in this case, I have the concrete implementation within the public class here. Okay, so it's pretty much, if you see, there is a, if you right click on the method here and it says create unit test. So this will be useful for those who want to create a unit tests and all, and it's going to create another assembly for you. And this dialog is trying to locate all the methods members for which you're going to create an assembly. And if I choose the respective one, it's going to create a separate project with the unit test case. Okay, so again, so it's trying to ask me for a test project, because I don't have a test project here, so it just created a test project. So if you have aware of the NUnit framework, which is used for creating the test cases, it is very popularly used in before the Microsoft have the unit test edition added up. So this is just a FYI, and also if you see these, this is a test case attribute that's added up, and the source code is completely created. Although this is just out of scope for our topics, but just a FYI, because it doesn't take much time. So this is pretty much, you can just evaluate your test cases and additional test attributes, so on. There's a lot. It's pretty easy to learn and run this. Not a very troublesome topic at all. Okay, so we are pretty much done with our topic for the day, and the last one to go, the default access modifiers. This is a very important one. So you can create a class. Another thing also, at the class level access modifiers, you cannot actually specify everything there. So there are some restrictions. So the class cannot be explicitly declared as private. This is a key thing. So these are again kind of interview questions. So you can, out of the 5 access modifiers, you can actually use only 3 access modifiers at class level. Okay, so you can actually make it as an can be explicitly declared as public and internal, and you cannot actually make it private explicitly. If I make it private, it's going to crib. It's going to simply say you cannot. See, it simply says the you cannot explicitly declare as a private, protected, or protected internal. And also you can make it as a public explicitly, also internal explicitly. So that's the kind of code I added up, actually separate access modifiers each of the code and trying to access the respective members. I just have the entire code created. So once you download this code, try all the different combinations, and before you dry out and deep into the code, keep it simple at your memory level, saying that the protected members relate to the inheritance hierarchy. Simply, okay, protected means inheritance hierarchy. So whichever class can inherit can access it. And when you say internal, it's internal to assembly. Map those keywords to the respective thing, then you're clear, gunshot answer. So if you say what is an internal, that means internals is, if you create anything internal, they are accessible throughout the assembly. Irrespective of what? Irrespective of inheritance or not an inheritance. Okay, that's a gunshot. A public you already know, private you already know, so no confusion there. So when it comes to protected internal, it's a combination of both. When it's protected, it's inheritance. Protected means anything available within the inheritance hierarchy within a class. If you make a protected member in a class, that is accessible throughout the inheritance hierarchy. It can be within the same assembly or outside the assembly. Simple, okay? And also internal, when you say internal is specific to only assembly. So it can be accessed throughout the assembly irrespective of the inheritance hierarchy. Okay, keep that answers simple, memorize that, and it should be good. And we were trying to do something here. Yeah, so I have the piece of code with the 3 different access modifiers here. So we just demonstrated only the public. I already have the code for internal class and also private class, which you can try it out for, by yourself. Just comment it out or uncomment it out and try it out yourself. You can see the differences. You shouldn't be a major difference, as we have seen the private members and public members all behave same irrespective of a class level or a field level or a property level or a method level. Okay, you can put the access modifiers. And this slide is pretty much talking about the default access modifiers. In the next section going forward, what I'm going to do is, since we covered almost the major topics right now, so we have a couple of small things here and there. I will cover them up in the next session. The structures have the default modifier as internal, and it can declare all the members like public, internal, and private. If you see, the structures cannot have a protected members. It cannot have a protected, but it can have internal. Why? Because the protected is equal to inheritance. Remember our small formula. So since structures cannot support inheritance, so they cannot have protected members, as simple as that. Okay, someone may ask you that simple question, like why structures can't have protected members. Before that, they might even ask, can you have protected members inside a structure? So the answer is no, because the protected, the simple equation we had is protected means inheritance. Okay, so just to keep our memory straightforward, that means you can access the protected members throughout the inheritance hierarchy. Since there is no inheritance in structures, there is no point of having protected members. So it doesn't have protected members. So methods, fields, and properties has a default access modifiers are private if no modifier is specified. So by default, they are going to be private. Okay, again, they are private by default, because again that reflects back to the principle of encapsulation, wherein all the private members are need to be protected or and exposed using a public members. So you explicitly need to specify that this is public so that you have more control over your local data members. So in this session 10, we did see the .ent modifiers to start with the access modifiers and an overview of what's an access modifiers we did see, and all the different types of access modifiers, which are ideally 5 types in C# and VB.NET: the private, public, protected, internal, and protected internal. All the different 5 different access modifiers we did walk through and drill down into details. In this diagram, we did show the red lines and the blue lines. So the blue lines indicating the access points, whereas the red lines indicating that no access zone. For private access modifiers, the members can be accessed only within the given class where it's declared. And for public access modifiers, everything is blue. It can be accessed from within the class, from within the assembly, as well as outside the assembly. We did see what's a friend in VB.NET and C#, internal in C#.NET, and the members decorated within friend in VB.NET and internal in C#.NET will be accessible only within the given assembly. They cannot be accessed outside the given outside the assembly. And protected members can be accessed only in the inheritance hierarchy. And it can span across multiple assemblies too. And finally, the protected friend access modifiers, they can, it's a combination of both protected and also internal in C#. So that means it can be accessed within the inheritance hierarchy as well as within the given assembly. Okay, and finally, this one quick diagram which shows the same like a subset set diagram to show the scope of each of these access modifiers. And finally, we will see what's a friend assembly in general, and also the default access modifiers. If you don't specify a given access modifier, what will the compiler internally interprets is what we did see, and see for C#, it's going to be a internal by default. Okay, so with that, we wind up session 10, and we'll continue with the next topics in next session.